He's the middleweight champion of the world. Germany. 31 fights, zero losses, one of boxing's pound-for-pound best.
He has heart, will, desire, determination. He's a gifted athlete, more gifted athletically than most boxers you'll ever see.
But recent lackluster performances have left some doubting his skills and questioning his desire.
People saw in Taylor a chance for a new star. The hope now is that he is willing to dig a little deeper.
Meanwhile, in the heart of Midwestern steel country, a new contender has risen, an undefeated knockout artist known as The Ghost.
Kelly Pavlik is a big physical middleweight. He destroys people when he hits them. It's scary sometimes. You know, I've seen him hit guys who are actually pissed herself in the ring.
Kelly Pavlik, you know, everybody told me he hit hard. So what? I'm middleweight champion of the world. That's what you gotta look at. I haven't lost.
He has to win, and really he has to win impressive. Kelly Pavlik is custom made for him.
Big right hand for Taylor. The kid is showing guts.
Well, Emmanuel Stewart's getting paid good money to say things like that. I have a feeling that Emmanuel's concerned. So is Jermaine.
You have these two prime undefeated middleweights in a head-to-head collision for the middleweight championship of the world. It's a throwback fight.
This is the story of a boxing superstar on a mission to reaffirm his greatness and a local hero hungry for the victory of a lifetime.
With those 5,000 jabs.
This is the countdown to Taylor Pavlik. For Jermaine Taylor, September 29th is about more than defending the middleweight crown. Instead, his bout with Kelly Pavlik is about validating years of work and sacrifice that have produced a brilliant pro career, a career that's recently been marked more by criticism than anything else.
Wait, watch me now. I'm coming, Kelly.
People saw in Taylor a chance for a new star in the prize-fighting heavens. And given the look he had and the story behind him and how he conducted himself, everybody thought that he could be a star, somebody who transcends the sport.
Taylor's story begins 2 decades ago, when as a young boy in Little Rock, Arkansas, his mother's late hours forced him to bear responsibilities his father had left behind.
My mother had to work, daddy wasn't there, so it was just me. I had to be the man of the house.
He made sure we did our chores. He made sure we were in the house on time. He made sure that we were very taken care of.
While keeping an eye on his sisters, Jermaine developed into a gifted athlete, and soon he found his way to Ozell Nelson's local gym, much to his mother's dismay.
Ozell had asked me once before, could Jermaine box? And, you know, I told him, hell no. Just like that.
She told me my son is not going to be no boxer. But Jermaine got in a little trouble, and I was driving to the neighborhood, and she flagged me down.
I ran out to him, and I said, hey, hey, you say you want Jermaine? Well, you can have him.
He gave me something to do. And my coach always told me, even though I got a crap beat out of me that first day, if I stick with it, you know, I'll be someone there.
That day came quickly for Taylor. His rise through the amateur ranks culminated with bronze medals at the 98 Goodwill Games and 2000 Olympics. Stardom was clearly imminent, and he joined the pro ranks soon after.
Jermaine was able to get kicks where he was able to knock out a bunch of them and was able to get his feet under him to get a real good foundation about where he was going, get that confidence.
He looked like a talented boxer puncher, good left jab, good power in his punches, in particular the right hand.
And when he became the middleweight champion in 2005, he got a whole lot of people that weren't otherwise boxing fans to become fans of Jermaine Taylor simply because he was their professional sports franchise.
Nowhere is that fan base bigger than in his home state of Arkansas. And some of the most valued support comes from a fellow favorite son.
How you doing?
I'm so glad to see you.
Thanks so much.
Good to see you.
I don't think he ever thought he would be sitting in the same room or even dining with
a former president of the United States.
We have two guys from Arkansas here. One's a boxer, and the other one's been a punching bag.
I've been a punching bag too, though, lately.
That was a big deal to him to meet the president.
He literally made boxing a big sport in our home state again.
Yes, sir.
Everybody, every time I go home, they talk about it. Everybody on the street knows who he is. It's great.
He has the cushion and the security of great accomplishment. He's unbeaten. He's the recognized middleweight champion of the world. He just hasn't fought somebody who can take that away from him yet.
Kelly Pavlik's story begins on the streets of Youngstown, Ohio. Once a thriving industrial capital, the city now struggles, but the spirit of hard work and perseverance remains.
I put 20 years in a steel mill. Everybody made a living here through the steel mills. Husbands went to work, wives stayed at home. Homes were built and college educations were funded through the mills. Now, they're all gone. No more mills. Nothing depleted. I just can't see.
It's a rough area. Youngstown is rough. You learn a lot growing up there. You know, it keeps you down to earth and humble. And you learn to work hard. Nobody had nothing given to him. Everything was just had to go out and earn it yourself.
When you know that he comes from Youngstown, then I say, I think I know that guy. He's a tough kid. And there's some kind of muscle memory in that region about what you do if you want to fight your way out and fight your way up.
Pavlik was the youngest of three boys, and though it would take him a while to step in the ring, the opportunity to fight was never far from reach.
You know, you have three boys in one little house, and you know, the tension builds, and it was always just flicks in the back of the head, and next time they come and do it again, it'd be harder, but then you sit there and you hit them, and that's what made me, I think, a little tough.
Of course, Kelly being the youngest, he always wanted to be part of whatever they were doing, and he would start with them, and they would end it rather quickly.
When brothers Ricky and Mike began spending time at the local Southside gym, 9-year-old Kelly pleaded with his parents to let him follow.
You know, at that time, there was a lot of kids around the same age, and you get in there, and you get beat up, and you get to punch somebody else, and, you know, beat them up, and it was just that contact, the one-on-one aspect of it that I fell in love with.
He was a ballsy kid. And he would spar whoever I put him in the ring with, and he took numerous butt kickings.
In the earlier days, I used to go down there after work, and I could see his enthusiasm, and I could see his confidence level growing.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, coach.
And I could remember the day that it all turned around. There was no more butt whoopings. Everything stopped.
The kids that were sparring with him all of a sudden wouldn't spar with him. Out of nowhere, he just started knocking people out, dropping people. It was two or three guys that were carried out on stretchers.
We would go into a fight, and we just knew that we were going to win the fight. To this day, we still know we're going to win the fight. He just goes into it with so much confidence. Well, he's expected to win and knows he's going to win, and that's the bottom line.
Pavlik steamrolled his way through the amateur ranks, and at the age of just 17, he qualified for the 2000 Olympic trials, where he was stopped by an amateur phenom out of Arkansas named Jermaine Taylor.
You know, it was a good fight. I can't say that I won the fight. You know, I'm not going to sit there and say I got robbed. He was experienced. He was older. You know, I learned a lot from that fight. And now I think the difference is that I'm 25 years old. I'm grown. I have a lot of experience behind me. And I think that's what the difference is going to be now.
Kelly was a baby. Kelly just turned 17 years old. Jermaine was a young man at the time. That's not even nowhere near a fair comparison. If that's what they're leaning on and going on, good. God bless them.
Jermaine won, and I think the same reason that he won then is why he'll win this time. His greater speed, better natural coordination, and then another major factor, the quality of guys that he's been fighting.
Jermaine's handlers hired Emmanuel Stewart because the feeling was that his craft was not progressing.
Emmanuel Stewart is one of the most respected trainers of his time. He's been brought in a number of cases to try to help retool a number of fighters.
I always thought that Jermaine Taylor was the best talent out of the Olympics of 2000. He had a good left jab, which is my favorite punch. He moved very fluently, put combinations together, but everything he did was behind a good left hand.
The newly forged Taylor-Stewart partnership debuted last June against one of the sport's premier defensive tacticians, Winky Wright. Stewart's game plan was clear and concise, but between the ropes, Taylor made it anything but a simple fight.
When Jermaine would follow Emanuel's instructions,
keep it in the center ring. You don't never get beat until you go back in the inner corner.
He would have a good round, and he would win the round.
He was a sitting duck for Taylor's power, and Jermaine took advantage.
And when he ignored Emanuel, he would lose the round.
Wright punches Taylor into a corner. He lands with accuracy and regularity and makes Jermaine look bad.
That was a decision that he made on his own. He did not follow orders. Later on, he realized then how wrong he was.
This bout is a draw. Jermaine Taylor retains his middleweight championship.
I just got to start listening and start doing what I'm told to do. And he told me to stay in the middle of the ring. That's why I should have stayed there.
I think he came out of that fight in fairly good shape as far as the public was concerned. But it was the fights following that where the suspicion started to come, well, maybe we had too much hope in this fight.
I think if you were to go out and look for two other opponents to make Jermaine look awkward, you could scarcely do better than Corey Spinks and Cassie Mumba. But he's still the winner of the fights.
And so there was some disappointment, disenchantment, that it wasn't working out.
Taylor is in a position where he's trying to justify the status that he's held for quite some time.
I'm winning. No matter what, may look bad, may look, you know, I'm winning. I still got the championship of the world, number one.
Still, winning those fights didn't prevent criticism from raining down on Jermaine from the unlikeliest of places, his hometown, as once devoted members of his bandwagon were suddenly showing how fragile loyalty could be.
We're Hot 96.5.
All right, hip-hop and R&B 96.5.
I'm actually riding in my car, and I hear the dude who to throw all kind of parties for me, and he on the radio talking about, I don't think Jermaine is the champ.
Hello, hello. Champ just walked in the building.
Champ's here.
I think what was so upsetting to Jermaine was the fact that a lot of the things got somewhat personal.
Champ gonna party, so if I can win a fight without getting a black eye or getting knocked out myself, that's how I'm gonna win it.
I don't care if Manny's in the corner with him or not. He's got to get that killer instinct back, or else, guess what? Kelly, on the 29th, it's over.
When I see him after the Kelly fight, don't speak to me. Don't come up to me. If you know, this is personal to me. This is my life.
He owned the town. He owned the state. But now he doesn't have that, and that's something that he's never experienced.
This is a nice reminder that if you want to stay in this level where people have a right to say these things, then you better keep performing.
For Taylor and Stewart, the Uma and Spinks fights are already well in the past. The focus now is on Kelly Pavlik's devastating knockout power. And in the gym, the pair is working to sharpen the fundamental skills that originally carried Taylor to the top of the middleweight division.
In the amateurs, he was a brilliant boxer puncher who everybody respected because he boxed so fluently. And recently, as a professional fighter, he's gotten into this habit of just dropping his left hand, bending down real low, taking his height away, no more footwork at all.
I got to get back to a lot of things that I did in amateurs. You know, I had a great jab. I still got a great jab, just haven't been using it. A lot more body punch, a lot more straight punches.
The opportunity is there to become a greater fighter, maybe even a truly great fighter, because he's working with a guy who's proven in the past that he can bring that out.
Emanuel Stewart, world-renowned boxing genius, versus a small-time, unknown trainer who's gotten to the big stage and will now be tested against the marquee trainer of the era.
I have an asphalt ceiling business, and it's hard, it's tough, it's hot, you know, it's dirty. I'm up at 5:30 in the morning getting ready to go out to work and do some driveways, do some parking lots. And then I'll take a break and I go walk and run Kelly, and then he goes home and I go back out and do driveways till it's time to come to the gym. So yeah, I stay busy. I always love contact, and I fought in the Golden Gloves. I just fell in love with the sport, and then I got married, and I just seen a vacant building, and the rest is history.
It's been 16 years since Kelly Pavlik first walked into Jack Lowe's tiny Southside gym. Since then, the two have forged a friendship rarely seen in the sport.
Jack Lowe has been with Kelly since he's been 9 years old. It's almost a father-son relationship now. He knows what Kelly feels when he's feeling it. He knows what to say to Kelly, what not to say to Kelly. They almost know what each other's thinking.
Stay behind that jab. Stay behind him. 1-1-2. 1-2.
I was fortunate. I mean, I was fortunate when Kelly walked through the door. I mean, tall, lanky little kid, and you know, he couldn't even walk and chew bubble gum. And never in the wildest dreams would I guess that he was going to be a world champ or be in a position we are now.
First thing I remember hearing about Kelly Pavlik, long before I had ever seen him fight, was this kid can punch.
You knew he had a good chin. You knew there was a stoutness about him. You had a feeling that he wasn't going to disappear when a moment came.
When we were coming up, I mean, I think they put the people in front of him that we were supposed to beat. But I think the way he was beating them surprised a lot of people. You know, he destroys people when he hits them. It's scary sometimes. I've seen him hit guys where actually pissed herself in the ring. He's a brutal, brutal puncher.
Pavlik scored knockouts in his first 14 professional fights. Night after night, bout after bout, winning was automatic, with the specter of a marquee opponent facing no one in Kelly's camp. Until last May, when at 30-0, Pavlik squared off with the formidable Edson Miranda.
They stepped up and took Miranda at a moment when I think there were a lot of other fighters in the division would have said, oh no, anyone but that guy. He told us the day before the fight, said, I'm going to back him up. Now, nobody else backed Edson Miranda up. Edson Miranda was the guy who backed you up.
It took real stones on Pavlik's part. It's one thing to say, I'm going to go in there and push this dangerous puncher backwards. And it's another thing to go in and do it.
From the opening bell, both fighters were on the attack.
They are trading bombs at short range.
But as the fight wore on, Pavlik took control.
Miranda is a bit thrown off by Pavlik coming at him.
I think around the fourth or fifth round, I mean, you just seen discouragement on Miranda's face walking back to his corner.
And Miranda is all but out on his feet as he slumps into the chair.
They were both trying to land the big shots that would take the other guy out. And from the beginning, Kelly showed superior craft. He showed greater will. He had a better understanding of what was going on in the ring. And ultimately, he set his man up and he knocked him out.
His right eye closing, and this is stoppage time. Kelly Pavlik has a huge knockout victory.
It was one of those moments where you don't need more than 10 or 20 seconds of observation to say, oh, I get it, he's a star.
The Miranda knockout marked the most significant victory of Pavlik's career. Now the number one contender, the next step was a middleweight title bout with Taylor. Amidst the celebration came the predictable onslaught of big-name trainers vying to take over for Jack Lowe. But Pavlik has remained loyal to the only coach he's ever had.
I think a lot of fighters don't know how to stand up for themselves, don't know how to put a stop to that, you know, instead of saying, you know what, where were you guys 5 years ago? I know what got me here. There's no way I'm going to change anything now.
Lowe has been with him from the beginning. Whether he does driveways or he does roofs or he flies planes or he's a doctor at night, he trusts him. They trust each other.
You know, Manny Stewart might not have been a great trainer for Kelly Pavlik, but Jack Lowe obviously is. We're 31-0 with 28 knockouts. We're fighting for the world championship. I still hear it, though. You know, Kelly should be, or Kelly needs a big-time trainer. That's bullshit.
Lowe's counterpart is no stranger to big fights. But this time, questions arose regarding his current student's alleged lack of focus in previous camps. So Stewart did as he's done with so many of his past world champions and sequestered Taylor at his isolated, custom-made training facility in the Poconos.
I asked one to pull out in the waist. Good.
What's my name?
No Stewart fighter has ever lost after training here, and Taylor has adjusted seamlessly.
Jermaine has never experienced this. It has everything that you look for in a training camp to me. It's serenity, it's quiet, it's peaceful. So when a guy trains here, he becomes totally absorbed, like 24 hours a day, his mind is into boxing.
It's a boxing environment. It's always quiet. I get up in the morning, I run, I don't even have no music on because it's so quiet.
Training in the Poconos means 8 weeks away from home. In the absence of wife and children, Taylor has done his best to keep things familiar.
Check me out, baby. I stuck it in there. Now, you hear me? We eating good tonight.
At his own expense, Taylor surrounds himself with his closest friends.
I got you.
For Stewart, an occasional juvenile diversion is a small price to pay for a renewed and singular focus.
Normally, when Jermaine leaves the gym, his mind is not into boxing. That his mind is on boxing now for probably about 12 hours a day as compared to where it used to be for 2 hours.
Among the benefits of isolation is Stewart's ability to teach in and out of the ring.
And a lot of what they're doing, they're using the upper body, the footwork, the hand feints, the shoulder feints, every trick in the book.
I know that Emmanuel tries very hard to get Jermaine to watch and appreciate great welterweights and middleweights of the past, hoping that he'll soak up from that not only some visual evidence of what great craft is, but also the desire to be that great a fighter.
But Stewart's library isn't limited to vintage fights. Pavlik trains hours away, but his face is familiar at Camp Taylor, and lessons are taught in absentia.
To give you some points, too, stop leaning in with your head so much. I'm watching the tape, you leaning in like this. Scoot back a little bit, I do the same thing.
He has to win, and really he has to win impressive. And I think that Kelly Pavlik is custom made for him.
I finally got me a guy who's normal, who don't lunge in with his head or have his hands above his head, or who don't go in there fighting crazy.
He doesn't have the kind of one-punch power that Kelly Pavlik has demonstrated, but he probably has greater hand speed and a greater capacity to land punches in bunches.
Pavlik's going to be bringing it. He's not a slick southpaw who's going to be hiding somewhere trying to avoid contact. And so Jermaine knows what he's getting, because Emmanuel Stewart's going to be analyzing Pavlik, seeing how best to tactically exploit whatever Pavlik does wrong.
Don't tighten up so much, real loose, because that one punch can end the whole fight.
It's worth the experiment to see if putting him into secluded circumstances is going to help. And I think that Emmanuel's more comfortable that way.
This place, it's tough. You know, nothing's pretty here. Summer, it gets hot. You know, it's humid. It's you got to train. You got to run in that hot weather. The old steel mills, everything here is just pretty much not run down, but just cruddy. It keeps you hungry, you know? As were some fighters, such as Jermaine, they're up in the Poconos where it's nice and pretty, beautiful scenery, everything's there that he needs. There's nothing that keeps him hungry up there. This is my block. This is where I used to live. Pretty much still do.
While Taylor secludes himself 1,000 miles from Arkansas, Pavlik has made a deliberate choice to stay in Youngstown. And though he owns a home nearby, while training, he lives in the same house where he grew up.
He's comfortable. And if we want to keep him comfortable. He runs, he comes home, we make him something to eat, we make him his breakfast, we make him his lunch, and we make him his dinner. Kelly!
Yes?
Come on. Everybody's pitching in to help Kelly with, you know, doing whatever they can to contribute to, you know, to his success in this fight with Jermaine Taylor.
I'm home, you know, I'm in here, and whatever I do here is going to benefit me as it did when I was 9 years old. They're watching me, everything I eat, you know, what I put in my body, if I'm a little tired, you know, and I say, well, I'll go run in an hour. No, you get up, you're going to run now.
As long as he's doing the right thing, then what's it matter if we're training in Vegas or we're training in Puerto Rico? You know, he's miserable when we go away. I don't get the best out of him, you know? And like I said, if he does the right thing while we're here, it doesn't faze me.
A major factor in Pavlik's decision to train at home is his 15-month-old daughter, Sydney. She lives nearby with her mother, and Pavlik sees her every day.
She's my life, you know, my baby. So everything revolves around her. Now it's, you know, not so much about me at all in that ring, or, you know, it's mainly about her, because I want to be healthy for her in the future, be able to, you know, go out in the backyard, play, do things with her. She's still very young, you know, 15 months, but I think she's slowly, you know, catching on to what I do and, you know, when I'm on TV and seeing me, so.
One family member who won't be watching Kelly is his mother. Debbie Pavlik refuses to watch any of her youngest son's fights as they happen.
My wife is very supportive of Kelly, and she wants to see him do well. She's very proud of him, but she's also terrified of the sport. She's so terrified of the sport that she'll never watch Kelly fight live. Never has watched him, and probably never will.
It's not very fun. it's not a nice thing. You know, it's stressful. You see your kid in the ring and, you know, getting hit, and you worry about him. Even when he's sparring, you're worrying about him.
In the same room where he began learning the sport 16 years ago, Kelly Pavlik now trains for the biggest fight of his life, though his regimen isn't confined to Jack Lowe's Southside Gym.
The way he trains, the way he works out, when it's time to buckle down, Kelly does the job. Once you get him to a certain place, we actually sometimes got to slow him down. He runs like a deer. He runs hard and fast, and he runs long. He runs a lot of hills.
One thing I think people take when they fight me is that they don't look like I hit that hard on film, you know, or that I'm that strong. And I think once they get in there, that's a big surprise to them.
He pushes 600-pound tires around, bangs sledgehammers off tires. He's just a physical kid. Condition-wise, I don't think you'll find a better conditioned fighter than Kelly.
Anytime I fight, I come to fight. There's no dancing around. There's no taking a break. You know, even when I get tired, I still throw a shitload of punches, and that's what I'm going to do in this fight.
Sparring partners, he's really rough on them. You know, I warn him coming in, you know, you're not getting paid till the end of the week, and if you don't last till the end of the week, you're not getting paid.
He's strong. Both his hands feel like right hands. Jermaine got too many flaws to walk over him. He couldn't even beat Corey Spinks. He couldn't even score a knockdown with Corey Spinks. Corey Spinks backed him up, so imagine what this guy's going to do.
Kelly Pavlik is a big physical middleweight, and there's just not a chance of him backing us down and pushing us around in that ring.
I just don't believe that there's a middleweight in the world out there that's going to be able to hold on to Kelly and last with Kelly for 12 rounds. He's just a big, brutal, strong middleweight.
It wouldn't be at all surprising to see both fighters hurt. I wouldn't be stunned to see both guys on the canvas. The beautiful thing is that they're tailor-made for each other.
When you look beyond Miranda and you ask anyone about Kelly Pavlik, there is no other career because he's never fought a quality named fighter, let alone beat him, not even fought a quality fighter.
Well, Emmanuel Stewart's getting paid good money to work for Jermaine Taylor's corner and say things like that. I have a feeling that Emmanuel's concerned. So is Jermaine. He is going to have no choice but to fight in this fight.
What I got to prove? He got something to prove. I am the middleweight champ of the world, and it's going to take a bad somebody to take that away from him. Now, he got to fight me, so he better get ready. He better be ready.
This fight should provide action. This fight should provide drama. If you want to see boxing the way you think in your heart that it used to be, this is the fight to see.
You have these two prime undefeated middleweights in a head-to-head collision for the middleweight championship of the world. It's a throwback fight.
In the boxing sky, this is the birth or rebirth of a star.
The middleweight championship showdown between Jermaine Taylor and Kelly Pavlik takes place Saturday, September 29th. And immediately